Okay, so I'm going to start off with my disclosure. I'm the research director at Human, and we sell an exogenous ketone ester. I'm not a clinician, but perhaps a bit more relevant right now is I'm an athlete, a recovering athlete. I spent 4 years of my life spending 3 hours a day sitting down, going backwards in a circle around a rowing lake in a ditch in the UK. I was a member of the British International Rowing Team. So a number of speakers have touched on the potential role for exogenous ketones in a variety of different applications. So I'm going to try and bring some of this all together and give you a framework so that we can really appraise how exogenous ketones can be used for health and performance, and how does this fit in with how we know that the ketogenic diet works. Now, really, when we're looking at this field, the devil is in the details. There are a lot of differences between exogenous ketosis and endogenous ketosis. There are differences between different ketone compounds in terms of what they do in our physiology, but also considerations such as price and taste, all of these things that are going to affect their application as we go forwards. That's the pointer. Okay. Which one? Green button. Okay, having two is confusing. Could I just see a show of hands who's ever tried an exogenous ketone? Loads of people, excellent. So gonna define exogenous ketones for today as a substance that you consume that contains ketones that are bioidentical to the ones that our bodies produce. And after consuming them, you end up in a state of mild acute ketosis. Now, this brings me to my first detail we need to be cognizant of. Ketosis, up until now, has really been used to refer to the state of ketogenesis, the state of having high ketones in the blood, and also the state of increased ketone oxidation. But now, with exogenous ketones, we can have hyperketonemia and increased ketone oxidation without ketogenesis. So that really leads to a number of key differences between exogenous and endogenous ketosis, which we'll run through quickly now. With exogenous ketones, the time of onset is very rapid. Peak ketone levels are often reached between 30 to 90 minutes after consuming a ketone supplement. But that's not maintained for all that long. So within 3 to 4 hours, levels of ketones have returned to whatever your baseline was before. So it requires top-ups to maintain ketosis. With exogenous ketosis, you do not need to restrict carbohydrates to have ketones in the blood. And this, as many of our speakers have alluded to, has interesting applications where settings where levels of ketones are important and adherence can be difficult, such as in a pediatric population or an elderly population, or perhaps in certain physical situations like with the military or elite athletes where carbohydrate restriction may be less easy to implement. One key difference is lipolysis. With endogenous ketosis, you have a high rate of lipolysis, and that's what's driving ketone production. And that's why ketogenic diets are successful for weight loss. However, with exogenous ketones, they actually are anti-lipolytic because ketones antagonize the nicotinic acid receptor and thus decrease plasma free fatty acids. So don't pay any attention to any headlines you read in trashy magazines saying that ketone drinks are the next miracle weight loss pill in a bottle. That's definitely not true. And then to speak to really a lot of what Jeff and Steve were just saying, long-term adaptations occur during endogenous ketosis that and we really don't know if any adaptations occur to exogenous ketosis. So this is at the moment our understanding of it is as a short-term strategy to provide ketones as a fuel. But to echo a theme again talked about by many of our speakers, BHB, the molecule itself, is interesting in terms of its role in not only fuel metabolism, but neuroprotection, inflammation, oxidative stress. And so there may be some overlap in the benefits between endogenous ketosis and exogenous ketosis, whilst there are clearly still settings where the state of whole body carbohydrate restriction is important, and on the flip side, settings where having both ketones and carbohydrate present in abundance is of advantage. So I'm just going to give a quick run through of the different types of exogenous ketones that are out there. Medium-chain triglycerides. Now, according to my definition, these wouldn't technically be considered as an exogenous ketone, as they're actually a fat that our body metabolizes into ketones. Typically, after consuming a standard dose of MCT, as Stephen Cunane showed earlier, levels of blood ketones are anywhere between 0.5 to 1 millimolar. Next up, ketone salts. Now, these are the most widely available exogenous ketones right now. Typically, ketone salts use beta-hydroxybutyrate as it's more stable and easier to formulate than acetoacetate. The ketone is bound by a mineral to a mineral ion, typically sodium, potassium, calcium. And I do think in the future it'll be interesting to see whether we get more sophisticated ketone salts, perhaps using a charged amino acid such as lysine or arginine. Now, this brings me on to a second detail, and this is talking about the difference between different types of ketone compounds. So in ketone land, there's this property called optical isomerism. So I like to describe it to people as we have a left hand and a right hand, four fingers and a thumb. They don't overlay on one another. And beta-hydroxybutyrate has the same property. These two isoforms exist, and our body generally or exclusively produces and metabolizes D-beta-hydroxybutyrate. That said, L-beta-hydroxybutyrate is present in trace amounts intracellularly, and some early work in animal models has shown that it can be used in beta oxidation, it can be used in lipid synthesis and sterile synthesis, and under certain conditions slowly can undergo conversion to other physiological ketone bodies. However, it doesn't appear to be as meaningful an oxidative fuel as D-beta-hydroxybutyrate. So what you're looking at here is blood ketone levels after consumption of 24 grams of a racemic ketone salt. And the white squares at the top are L-beta-hydroxybutyrate levels. So you can see that after the drink, they rise and they stay elevated, indicating that it's being metabolized slowly in comparison to D, which rises to a lesser extent and then falls back to basal levels after about 3 hours. And if we take this out even longer, you're seeing here the data from 4 hours, 8 hours and 24 hours, LBHB is still significantly elevated after 8 hours. So it doesn't look like it's contributing as much to oxidative metabolism as D. However, that is interesting if it is able to signal equivalently to D-beta-hydroxybutyrate. And it's very, very early stage research and not at all clear at this stage, but it is possible that L-beta-hydroxybutyrate could scavenge reactive oxygen species similarly to D-beta-hydroxybutyrate and may also bind with a similar affinity to the nicotinic acid receptor. So really we need to characterize what happens to the body with the physiological isoform and understand the thresholds, and then we will really be able to compare what happens when we give just, say, L in isolation. But I could certainly see a role for these as a longer acting form of exogenous ketones in the future because they're not being metabolized. And finally, ketone esters. Now, these have perhaps been surrounded by a little bit of mystique because they used to cost a ridiculous amount for a tiny amount. They taste like jet fuel, according to most people. But actually, just talking about ketone esters again is a little bit misleading because there's many different types of ways that we can glue ketones to other things using ester bonds. Different ketone esters behave differently in the body, and so we really need to be specific when we talk about which ketone ester is being studied. So there are two kind of being discussed in the literature right now, the acetoacetate diester that's being worked on by Dr. D'Agostino and Dr. Poff, as they discussed earlier, and the beta-hydroxybutyrate ketone monoester. Now, the acetoacetate diester is made up of two parts acetoacetate bound to 1,3-butanediol. And actually, as Dr. D'Agostino and Dr. Poff were mentioning, it's actually showing a lot of promise in central nervous system CNS oxygen toxicity and cancer. And actually, in those settings, it outperforms supplementing with beta-hydroxybutyrate, which I think is really interesting because it really highlights that there are differences between these compounds. They're not just the same. There is only one human study to date, and that was kind of hobbled by poor tolerability issues, but I think it's really interesting to see where this ester goes in the future with the research. Next up is the beta-hydroxybutyrate monoester that was developed out of a collaboration between the NIH and the University of Oxford. This compound is made up of one part of D-beta-hydroxybutyrate bound to one part butanediol, and it's been fairly widely studied in humans as around about 250 human participants in the studies to date. A lot of these are focused in on exercise physiology, but there's also data around the regulation of blood glucose, lipids, appetite, and a few early clinical studies as well. And this compound is classified as generally recognized as safe by the US FDA, so it's available now as a commercial product. So I just want to wrap up this little section by talking about the differences we need to consider between the ketone supplements that are available, focusing in on the racemic BHB salt and the D-beta-hydroxybutyrate ketone ester. First up, in terms of the level ability to raise ketone levels, I would caveat this by saying that for a number of different endpoints, we don't know the therapeutic level required or the effective level required. So I guess what I would say at this point is that the beta-hydroxybutyrate ketone ester allows a very flexible range of ketosis anywhere between 0.5 up to 7 millimolar. We can titrate up and down with the doses, whereas salts tend to be stuck around about 1 millimolar increase. What you're looking at here is consumption of 24 grams of beta-hydroxybutyrate as either a ketone ester or a ketone salt. And you can see that the ester reaches a peak beta-hydroxybutyrate level of around 3 and the salt around 1, although some of that is obviously L-beta-hydroxybutyrate, as you saw earlier. And on the right, you can see I pulled out the peak beta-hydroxybutyrate levels reported in all of the studies of ketone salts to date. So those really range between 0.4 and 1 millimolar. So it's fairly standard that with a racemic salt, I think that's probably the limit of the technology right now. But still, obviously, some developments happened there. Next up, what about practical considerations? So the ketone salts come with quite a high mineral load and the LBHB, and the ketone esters are still costly and still taste, we like to say it tastes like it works, but some people like it, some people don't. You'll have to try some one time and tell me what you think. But then the issue I want to address within a little bit more detail is the issue of GI tolerability, because I actually think that, broadly speaking, exogenous ketones get a pretty bad rap. So what I was doing in my studies at Oxford, at every time point that I collected a blood ketone reading, I asked people how they felt, and they had 12 symptoms that they could rank between 0 and 8. So at any one time point, if they were at death's door, they could have given it a score of 96 in terms of severity. And so I averaged this out over all of the participants in my studies. On the left, you can see symptoms after 12 grams of ketone ester and ketone salt, and on the right, after 24 grams of ketone ester and ketone salt. And you can see that the maximum on this axis is 3. So all the supplements are really quite well tolerated. That's between mild and moderate. On the left, you can see there's very little difference between the esters and salts, and the symptoms are highest directly after the drink, but really they go down, and it's not that much to speak of. When you increase the dose, symptoms increase with both compounds, increases by more with the ketone salt, and I would say we saw more lower GI issues potentially because of the mineral load. But I do think that these compounds have been demonized a little, and to further emphasize that point, this is data collected during a 3-hour exercise study with ketone ester compared with a multiple transportable carb drink. And the black square is the carb drink. So people are having more symptoms with the carbs than with the ketone, but it's still mild. The maximum on this axis is 1.8. So I think that with proper dosing and proper formulation, we can really work around these and make these quite a practical intervention for athletes and for the broader community. So be careful how you use the word ketosis, endogenous, exogenous. It matters now that people are out there using exogenous ketones. And also pay attention when you read the literature. Was it a DL salt? Was it D or L? What type of ketone ester was used? And you know, also pay attention to tolerability. And let's work as a community to refine that and make this like, you know, practical strategy going forwards. So I'm now just going to finish up my section of the talk by talking about the exercise studies I was involved with at the University of Oxford using the D-beta-hydroxybutyrate ketone ester. And I want to say at this point that I'm really, really standing on the shoulders of giants here. You know, I was involved. I've been involved for 8 years, but a lot of the work was done before I arrived by Dr. Richard Veach and Professor Kieran Clark, who developed the ester, and then Dr. Pete Cox, who pretty much single-handedly conceptualized and ran the series of studies I'm about to talk to you about. So we published in Cell Metabolism in 2016, and as I said, this was 5 studies of athletes that were following a mixed diet, so they were not on a ketogenic diet. It was a randomized control trial, so they completed both conditions, and they either consumed ketone ester with carbohydrate or carbohydrate alone. So this isn't just a straight up ketone versus carbs consumption. This is how does ketones add to the current gold standard. The exercise protocols vary slightly study to study, but generally the exercise intensity was between 70 and 75%, which is typically regarded as being quite heavily dependent on carbohydrate. And all of these athletes were, you know, just sub-elite, very well-trained athletes. So the first finding is that ketones can provide quite a substantial energy source and be oxidized during exercise. The red line at the top is ketone levels at rest. And then if you have the same drink and start exercising at 40% or 75%, ketone levels fall in an intensity-dependent manner. And we calculated out that we believe that ketone oxidation was accounting for somewhere between 16 to 18% of energy expenditure during these conditions. And we actually calculated that we believe we were oxidizing about 0.5 of a gram per minute of ketones. So it's, you know, it's contributing as an oxidative substrate. But I think probably what's more profound is the effect on other aspects of substrate metabolism, specifically carbohydrates, fats, and proteins, all of them. But carbohydrates first, let's start there. So this is muscle glycogen pre and post exercise. You can see that typically when you exercise with carbohydrates, you burn through glycogen. That's the gray bars. As whereas if you have ketones plus carbohydrates, you get a profound glycogen sparing effect during exercise. This picture of carbohydrate sparing continues when you look at the levels of blood lactate during exercise. Consistently, we were seeing 2 to 3 millimoles less blood lactate when ketone ester and carbohydrate was consumed compared to just carbohydrate alone. And when we looked in detail in the muscle, we did metabolomics and looked at all of the intermediates of glycolysis, and it wasn't just an inhibition at the level of PDH. There wasn't like a backup. The whole glycolytic pathway was down, but they're actually completing the same workload through a completely different metabolic pathway. What about muscle branched chain amino acids? Now, sometimes proteins are deaminated during exercise to provide a substrate for metabolism, and actually taking ketones before exercise attenuated this rise, suggesting that perhaps using ketones before exercise could help to spare muscle mass. And finally, what about fat? This is a little bit like how Jeff was talking about earlier. We saw this effect and we couldn't really explain it. We saw a very, very big increase in intramuscular lipid oxidation. And to me, it's a little odd because ketones inhibit lipolysis, but increased intramuscular fat oxidation. This is the graph on the left here. You can see change from baseline. So ketone, taking ketone before exercise increased the amount of intramuscular lipid you burn by about 25%. And we're not really sure why that was. Mechanism still unclear, but it's certainly interesting and potentially could have disease implications. And so, as I said up until here, this is all of the data up to this point has been showing you how we're completing the same metabolic output, the 70% max intensity cycling, with a completely different metabolic phenotype. So what happens when we take the brakes off and let these athletes go full pelt down the track? So we did a study where you did 60 minutes of pre-fatigue and then a 30-minute time trial for distance. And we saw that athletes improved by about 400 meters, 2.3%. And just to really contextualize that, I worked out that distance would be the difference between first and eighth position in the Olympic road race. The Nike two-hour marathon project, they were 1 second a mile short of breaking 2 hours. So at elite levels of sport, this kind of thing is certainly interesting and could really move the needle. This isn't an isolated result. In 2016, Dr. Andrew Murray, who was previously at the Oxford Group, now is at the University of Cambridge, published a study in FASEB that looked at treadmill endurance of rats running each day for 7 days, fed ketone ester, a high carbohydrate diet, or a Western diet high in carbohydrate and fat. And he found that each day they were running, the rats were running around 33% further with the treadmill. So obviously a more of an extreme result there, but it's more a signal, you know, to that this effect is to be believed. And then finally, there is a study of British elite rowers, of which I was one, doing a 30-minute time trial for distance again. This is available online in one of our patent applications. It's not yet published. But again, there was a 1.3% improvement in endurance performance. So we're still a little way from really knowing, you know, exactly how best to use these. But the physiological shift is very, very profound. And I'm really excited to see where this field goes. And we're trying to answer some of these questions now. So I'm going to hand over at this point to Dawn, who is going to talk to you about some of our current research efforts.